Apologies for us being a little delayed. If you've noticed, we're all super duper dressed. We look like a fashion something or other. Gentlemen in ties, women all spiffy. It's because we had our picture taken. So that delayed us just a little bit. So thank you for allowing us to do that part of our work. And I also wanted to acknowledge for those who are coffee drinkers that we do have coffee in the back. So Dr. Britt, that's for you. So good evening. And tonight we are pleased to announce that we have our student, Miss Ella Sexton, with us. Miss Sexton will be reciting a poem, and this is in light of our second Artist of Promise evening that occurred last Tuesday. It was held at Scottsdale Community College, and there was performers in poetry, creative writing. I believe there was some film I'm getting, and fashion. Yeah, and I'm disappointed I wasn't able to be there, which I had planned to do, but life gets in the way sometimes. However, I did hear that we had a very poignant poem that the recipient received the first place award for poetry. And I'm going to read a little bit about her before we give her a huge round of applause. So she's going to be reciting a poem for us. And Ms. Sexton is a second year student at Paradise Valley Community College. She plans to transfer to ASU so she can continue to study psychology and English and pursue her writing. She has loved writing since she was very young. As a writer, she's inspired by the idea that her work could manage to reach people and bring them comfort and representation. Her biggest aspiration in life is to be in a position where she can help and connect with people through a career and or creative work. I would expect with your writing, you'll be able to connect with lots of people. Ms. Sexton participated at the Artists of Promise Gala that took place at Scottsdale Community College on April 18th. She was the first place winner for her poem, Downsizing. So let's greet her warmly and congratulate her. And before we call our meeting to order, Ms. Sexton, the podium is yours.
Now it's on. Yes. So President Sullivan, members of the board, Dr. Gonzalez, members of the CEC and guests, my name is Ella Sexton. I'm a student at Paradise Valley Community College, and I will be reading my poem for you titled Downsizing. Gold white in the sun, big paws in the rock backyard of our little house. We worked so hard for this house. Do they know that? It's small, but it's new. It smells like paint still, and it's ours, after years of not having anything that was. It's hot, 100, cicadas screaming in the neighbor's pine tree. They fired my dad today, told him he wasn't good enough. I was angrier than he was. My father, he doesn't get angry, but they don't know that. That dog loves him more than anyone else, sits by him on the couch, nose on his leg, pleading unnecessarily for the love that he can't help freely giving out, despite the food bank childhood, the evictions, the you're just not the right fit, the return to sender on the wedding invitation that he sent his own father, the scar down the center of his chest, the totaled cars, the 20 pounds lost in 6 weeks, the we're just looking for different skill sets, the promised checks that never arrive in the mail. Despite big company, big men, big houses, have spent their lives owning everything, spent their lives eating the guts out of people like us, like him. But he's chasing the dog in the backyard, grinning, sun swelling off his black and white hair, super glued pair of glasses slipping down his nose because, of course, he never replaced them. Tinny Fleetwood Mac on the transistor radio because, of course, he'll never use his phone. And somehow I don't care about the CEOs in blood-smeared suits. Our blood. because they don't know us. He wasn't happy there. He saw it coming, and he's moving my mother's sagging camping chair to run after Casper some more. I don't know, but we'll find a place in the chaos. Somewhere in this ending world, we'll find a corner of sunshine and rocks and golden retrievers. Me and him, we're going to spit the blood right back into their faces. Thank you.
Ms. Sexton, that's an extremely powerful poem. Moving on, we are live captioning our meetings, so please look in the window of our WebEx meeting where you will find a link. Please click on that link to open a web page with the live captioning. And with that, I'm going to, at this time, call to order the regular meeting of the Maricopa County Community College District Governing Board for April 25, 2023. For the record, I'm going to now call a roll call of members, and I'll start with our student trustee, Mr. Burnett.
Present.
Thank you. Ms. Bittersmith.
Here.
Thank you. Ms. Butler. Thank you. Ms. Davis.
Here.
Thank you. Dr. Nerini.
Present.
Thank you. Ms. Smith.
Present.
Thank you. Dr. Thor.
Present.
With my presence, all board members are present. We have a full quorum. And with that, we'll move into the Pledge of Allegiance. Ms. Sexton, will you please join us at the podium and recite the pledge for us tonight?
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you, Ms. Sexton, and good luck with all your endeavors and aspirations. One more round of applause for her, please. She can't join or stay with us because she's going on to class. Drive carefully. Thank you. We have some substitutions this evening. Miss Mary Droysen is sitting in for Tammy Robinson, president of Mesa Community College. We're now going to move to our student life reports. Today is from South Mountain Community College. I'd like to welcome the student life and leadership group. And I understand that a few students and their advisor, Mr. Ralph Thompson, are here with us tonight. So, Mr. Thompson, hello. Would you please introduce yourself and our students? You look like you need your taking photos too.
Good evening.
Evening.
President Sullivan, governing board members, Chancellor Gonzalez, Dr. Daniel, members of CEC, colleagues, guests, friends that are here tonight. My name is Ralph Thompson. I have the distinct pleasure of presenting South Mountain Community College's Student Governance Council, who will share the experiences of relearning how to be social while on campus. Daniel Duarte, our STUGO president, will lead the conversation. Daniel.
Hello, we are Student Governance. This year, we have worked together to ensure the student voice of South Mountain is heard and that our students are as active outside the classroom as much as they are inside of our classrooms. I would like to introduce the members of STUGO Council: Declan Jones, treasurer; Kevin Nguyen, secretary; Andrea Willetto, marketing; Naya Vasquez, marketing; and Christian Agbu, member at large. Next slide, please. STUGO is a part of the shared governance process where all voices are heard and matter, including the student voice. STUGO leaders serve a role on each of the councils. Daniel, Shared Governance Council; Andrea, Student Development Council; Declan, Learning Council; Kevin, EONT Council.
Student governance was active in the interview and selection process of President Dr. Daniel. Upon his arrival, he has been active, and we've had the pleasure of getting to know him through multiple events, such as our Breakfast Burritos with the President event.
Next slide.
Coming out of the pandemic, South Mountain Community College's campus community has had to relearn how to be social. That was one of our biggest models for student governance. It has been a slow process, but with SUGO leaders leading and with help from student life and leadership, we've had multiple events and activities on campus that have led to more interaction and connections among students and faculty.
Next slide, please. Oh, the one before that. This year we opened the game room and here are some of our students who are enjoying their time in it. This created more flow and activity through campus. Next slide. These are some of the active clubs we have on campus that we're excited to work with. Black Student Union, Circle of Nations, Christian Challenge, Mecha, Male Empowerment Network, as well as South Pride, as well as Women Rising.
While also focusing on relearning to be social, we also promote making connections, volunteering, and health and wellness.
Next slide, please. Here are, the slide before that. Sorry. We do have some pictures somewhere on the slide. Keep going. Okay, there we go. Here are some pictures of the events that we've had the pleasure of hosting this school year. We have the open mic night, the first gen, Loteria, Dementia and Friends, Hip Hop and Wings. We had also end of semester and then a welcome back week. And then we also had the reopening of the game room. You could go to the next slide. And then here are a list of those events. These events have helped the students at South Mountain relearn to be social while also staying safe. There are other events that are not listed on here that Stugo has participated in that were led by other clubs.
Next step. Lastly, we would like to leave you with SMCC's greatest treasure, the village. This is a two-pronged approach to engage students. We offer snacks once a day at Gables Pantry, as well as provide students the opportunity to shop at the village. We served over 100,000 pounds of food over the past year. We strive to be a model for what the food pantry and serving students should look like. Next slide, please. Thank you for your time and support for student success.
I think the transition to be social has been hard for a lot of us. The board found itself not even knowing each other face to face for how many years, too. So I applaud your efforts, and I know all of us recognize that it's not easy to all of a sudden go from not knowing one another, not having relationships, and having to do that throughout the whole campus. So I think it's admirable that that is what you chose to focus on and continue to do the work you're doing, because it'll make a difference. Thank you. Moving on then to our faculty council report, Dr. Newton.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Good evening, President Sullivan, governing board members, Chancellor Gonzalez, CEC colleagues, and guests. It is incredible the difference that 5 years can make. 5 years ago, on February 27th, 2018, I was the Faculty Senate President at South Mountain Community College, and I sat with hundreds of colleagues in one of the district's satellite rooms that they had to create because there were too many attendees at that governing board meeting that evening. On what Dr. Thor called a dark day in Maricopa history, a majority of governing board members voted to tear up the residential faculty agreement, abolish the collaborative administration and faculty policy team known as Meet and Confer, and finish the goal they'd begun when they ended staff representation. They gutted shared governance in the Maricopa County Community Colleges. 5 years later, complete with 2 years of COVID smack dab in the middle, I stand here as Faculty Association President, and I would argue that we are in the midst of a renaissance of shared governance in Maricopa. Due to the dedicated work of the Chancellor, our governing board, and the leadership of faculty, staff, and administration, together this year, we have solidified the foundation of academic freedom, freedom of speech, and shared governance in our district. The results are remarkable. We have an active and thriving Committee on Academic Freedom with increased requests for support and clarification coming from our Maricopa community. We have a dedicated team of leaders exploring the creation of a structure for shared governance, a testament to our commitment of not only the principles, but the application. We developed a new strategic plan from start to finish that involves stakeholders, including retreats that brought together Maricopa faculty, staff, administrators, with governing board and community members. We all work to envision together the future and priorities of Maricopa. The Compensation Advisory Committee and Advisory Budget Committees have worked collaboratively to propose compensation plans for faculty, staff, and adjuncts that support the governing board's commitment to equity and fiscal responsibility. We have three effective teams established for policy development that have resulted in policy documents for residential faculty, staff, and adjuncts. And in true Maricopa acronym love, those teams are the RFACT, the SPCT, and the AFHCT. Finally, this year saw the work to finalize the performance success evaluation model for staff and implementation plans to begin pilots in fall 23 and launch in fall 24. This has been a heavy lift and a team effort. I was proud as faculty to be part of this incredible work for our staff colleagues. And those are only the large endeavors that I'm talking about for the past year. We have lots of task forces and initiatives waiting in the wings to launch. It is incredible to see the difference it makes when we bring stakeholders together early in the decision-making processes that help propel us forward to support our students and our communities. That work isn't always easy, and it's certainly not always fast. And shared governance is a fragile construct that will always require vigilance and effort. But that progress is clearly worth that commitment. In this, my final presentation before the board as Faculty Executive Council President, I want to take just a moment to thank those who've made it possible for me to contribute during this renaissance to the work of shared governance in Maricopa. First, thank you to my colleagues on CEC. Those early morning phone calls, late emails, emergency meetings in the hallways with all of you are a testament to our willingness to collaborate, explore options, and give grace to each other as we address the inevitable challenges and opportunities that we face in a complex system like Maricopa. I have appreciated your generosity. Sorry, I can never get this in the right place. I have appreciated your generosity, and I look forward to continued work together. Next slide, finally, Elsa. I told her it was going to be forever on that one. All right. Thank you and recognition to my Faculty Association officers, without whom I would not be hashtag vertical. So past President John Champel, right back there, has been on FEC since 2013, and I have appreciated his passion for shared governance and his knowledge of faculty leadership, but mostly his willingness to straight shoot with me when I asked him for it. You're about to meet President-elect Lisa Marcio, who has already established her commitment to leadership, Maricopa, and faculty, and I look forward to supporting her and her intelligence, integrity, and the kindness with which she will fill this role. I have turned to Sasha as a touchstone in all things, to Megan for her generosity of spirit and rhetorical savvy, to Liz for her ability to provide clarity and focus, to Corey for quiet strength and determination, and to Barry and Jim for their institutional knowledge and experience. These officers have provided the brains and the hands behind the scenes that make this job possible. The role is and always will be a team effort, and I have been lucky and grateful to have them at my back. I'm not going to do that. Thank you. Oh, next slide, please. Thank you to the members of the Faculty Executive Council, especially those Faculty Senate presidents up there who ensure that their college colleagues are informed and are participating at the college and district level in the shared governance of our district. We all of us, benefit from their efforts on behalf of their colleges, and I have benefited from their perspectives, their work, and their collegiality. Finally, thank you to the strong and dedicated faculty of Maricopa. When shared governance was endangered in Maricopa, they rallied and they worked and they leveraged national institutions in higher education and our legal system to restore what had been lost. When faced with an unprecedented global pandemic, they pivoted, they learned, they reached out and supported despite often personal struggles. They reached out to their students, their colleagues, and their colleges because they wanted to make sure access to the promise and power of higher education was still available. And in this new era of collaboration and partnership, they've willingly stepped up when asked to serve on the councils, committees, task forces, and teams that shared governance requires. And they do that while doing their day job, making sure that they are providing excellence in teaching and learning and excellence in education. It has been my privilege and my honor to represent and to serve them. These monthly addresses have been one of the most nerve-wracking parts of this job. But I will always be grateful for the opportunity to share the good work of faculty. As always, thank you for your time and your attention. Good evening.
So Dr. Newton, good work demands good leaders. So obviously your colleagues and everyone else believe that you've done a great job. So congratulations. Plus it was fun with you being cheeky up here. So we'll have to see if Lisa does that too. Just kidding. Thank you again. Moving on, we have a presentation this evening from our adjunct faculty group, and Mr. Paul Franco-Riak is presenting. I said that almost right. It's like, perfect. Oh my God, but welcome.
Thank you. Thank you. It's a tough act to follow. Chairperson Sullivan, board members, Chancellor Gonzalez, distinguished educators, Maricopa County, all. Thank you for having me. The little tagline for the report's kind of light this week, getting ready for the heat. We are kind of, things are heating up for the adjunct faculty, and we're getting ready to meet the deadlines that we've set for ourselves and move forward on the main initiatives that I've been telling you about. So next slide, please. The adjunct faculty awards are coming up, and I would just like to, at this point, point out the benefits of board member attendance at the adjunct faculty awards that will be held in this room on Friday. You could almost wait at the bar at this point. It's only a couple of days away in this very room. So it's right here in this room. It's this Friday. It's a delicious banquet. You're going to have excited, happy people meeting awards. Now, we heard about a horrible day to start out this meeting, but I got to tell you, we're going to take 30 people in this district and make them the happiest, smilingest folks. They're going to say when they come in on Monday to their office, and it might be here, it might be somewhere else, and they say, hey, what did you do this weekend? Those folks are all going to say, well, you know, I wasn't going to say, but it was a pretty good weekend. You know, I had dinner with the person who's running the organization over at the place that I work at. The chancellor was there to give a nice speech, tell me I was doing a good job. I got an award handed to me. Check it out. They're big. What you should see, they are big, beautiful awards. right from the provost going to hand out the awards. They read my bio up there. It was just great. So, you know, no matter what's going on with someone else, they're going to save that for their weekend. And we're making those 30 people that happy with what we've been doing. So I encourage you to come. I asked you last month if you bought your tickets. If you have, I'm buying them back. Man, I got people that are coming from Los Angeles. It's a hot ticket, okay? So if you have tickets, I'm buying. And I learned this from a guy outside. I'm selling too. I got three already made out to board member. If any of you guys want them, I'm buying, I'm selling. It's going to be great. It's going to be a great time. It's a tough ticket to get. I can probably get you up front too.
Take those gifts, you know.
Well,
our lawyer is sitting right there.
All right. Well, I'll.
But thank you.
All right. Well, you can, you know, there.
It's okay.
All right. I can get you up front. I mean, you guys, if you want, it's good seats.
Ms. Falkenberg, you're not listening, right?
All right. Anyway, and most of all, it's going to be outstanding company in addition to VIP seating and preferred parking. You're going to meet the leaders of the organization. They are the leaders of our group, are the best adjunct faculty members. When you look at just the statistics, 0.1% of folks get this award annually. Out of 3,500 people, we're honoring 30. That's got to make some people feel really good. That's you know, you talk about we're going to be a 4-year school now. Talk about tough to get in, man. That's these awards, okay? And I don't know the male-female ratio yet. That's just, they always say that when you're trying to get into a college. It doesn't seem important anymore. But certainly, you're welcome to come, and we would love to see you. And please, if you can, it's going to be a great, wonderful, fabulous evening. So I've shilled as much as I can for that, and I really hope you'll come. Next slide, please. We should really stick on this for just another set. Oh, Adjunct Faculty Corner, here we go. The third installment of the Adjunct Faculty Corner introduces our new leadership, and that's really nice. I'd like to announce that Kim Boge is going to be the new employee group president. Dr. Michael Littlecrew and Christina Gerges are the new vice presidents. We just had our election and they won. I would like to, we're glad to already be using the new communication tools we have at our disposal to get the word out. So that's already working. And, you know, that would have been a heavier lift for us if it wasn't just put into the newsletter that this is out there and just ready to go a week after we had the successful election that was competitive for the first time in quite some time. So that's great. There's more interest going on in serving in our employee group. And I think that's really important and a big plus. So next slide, please. The adjunct faculty bylaws, Kim Boach, who I introduced before, is working on getting the final draft of that written up for release to the board and to the administration, so we can make sure that we've included everything we need to include and that we're not breaking any rules that we would be running afoul of as an employee group. So that's going along good. And that will be, we're on schedule to meet our July 1st deadline. So that's Salen. I really appreciate her doing that. And I'm indebted to that whole group for working on that. So thank you. Big kudos to them. Next slide, please. Adjunct faculty elections. We're currently in an election cycle, not just for the vice president and the officers, but for the campus representatives. And again, these are very robust. I have to thank Dr. Robinson over at Mesa. We have a competitive election that we had with the one person leaving, we had no one in there. And you're always starting from zero versus if you got some coals going to keep things going, it's a lot easier. But we were starting, we were going to be starting from zero there. And with that intervention, we've really helped. Paradise Valley has a very robust election. Phoenix has a very robust election. Glendale has a very robust election. And everyone's really been helping us out with that. So that's great. There's a lot that don't have anybody running this year, so I'm not leaving anyone out. It just might be that their campus does not currently have a vacancy at the board, which is, that's great, no trouble. So thank everybody for that. That was really, really, really great. And I have to say, you know, it's better if we're moving away from coronations and having elections. It's nice when you have some competition. That just makes people feel a little better, and it's kind of a gestalt linkage. It makes people want to run. It makes us some greater than its part. So I think that's really important. We're, That interest is generated kind of organically. I would love to give someone the credit for that. I'm always up here saying thanks to everybody. I think that one's just thanks to everybody. That's a good one. So right on with that one. Next slide, please. Oh, my favorite. Adjunct faculty expertise. I always like to mention to you guys that adjuncts are a deep pool of talent who have already proven their dedication to this organization. One of my main messages to you always as president will be that we're reliable workers, who earnestly advance the interests of MCCD, and we're always looking for more opportunity to get involved. You know, it's we work cheap. So thank you so much, and that concludes my report.
Thank you very much.
Thanks.
Good job. Enjoy your year. We now have our staff representation report, Ms. Mange and Mr. Duvall. Welcome.
Good evening, President Sullivan, governing board members, Chancellor Gonzalez, President CEC. My name is Kelvin Duvall. I'm co-president of staff representation. Next slide, please. We want to thank the governing board for coming out and joining staff representation. We had a great meeting in toward the end of March, and we went over several very important topics, some very good, robust conversations. It's really good to have this shared governance where staff and the governing board can sit down, have conversations, and staff representation and the staff reps throughout the district really get a lot of that. It really gives them a lot of clarity on a lot of topics that it's hard to understand when you're down, you know, on the front lines, and there's a lot of stuff going on the high levels, and it's very beneficial to staff representation. I just want to say thank you very much for doing that. Next slide, please. We want to congratulate the district-wide Innovation of the Year Award, which went to Adult Education from Rio Salado College. That's a great program that's known for being collaborative, innovative, and what they're doing over there is amazing, and the best thing about it, it's scalable. So it's something that is very easy to replicate. So once again, staff representation wanted to give a shout out to Adult Education from Rio Salado. Thank you. Good job. Next slide, please. Also, a congratulations goes out to the DAC Award of Excellent Winners, the Diversity Advisory Committee. They hand out awards to every single unit. Every unit, every college, they have a lot of applicants. Really supporting diversity throughout the district, throughout all the colleges. This is a very important award. And I think every year when we get a very large pool of applicants, we clearly see all the good work that's really going on. And specifically these 11 winners, we wanted just to highlight them very quickly and congratulate them on a job well done and continuing the mission of Maricopa Community Colleges. So congratulations to all the winners. Next slide.
President Sullivan, members of the board, Chancellor Gonzalez, CEC and guests, my name is Shannon Mange, and I am co-president for staff representation. I think I may change it to Mange because I love when you say that, President Sullivan. It just sounds so fancy. I may go by that.
Wait a minute. I've been mispronouncing it.
I love the way you say it. My husband has taught me Mange, but when you say Mange, I'm like, ooh, I stand up a little straighter. I like it. We might have to do that.
I love French, so maybe that's why.
There you go. That's what we're going to do from now on. So one of the
bonjour, mademoiselle.
Merci. Yeah. One of the DAC awardees that we wanted to really highlight. I attended the award ceremony that day, and it was very moving, very beautiful ceremony. And seeing all the awards there, I normally do not show emotions very well, but I can definitely say that I was moved when hearing all of these presentations. So one that we wanted to highlight tonight is the third annual Two Spirit Powwows at South Mountain Community College. That event had over 2,500 attendees. It was a beautiful, amazing event. Diversity and inclusion are at the heart of the powwow's mission, bringing some of the area's best dancers together for fun and appreciation to celebrate the Native American Two-Spirit LGBTQ+ community. We want to say thank you to Gerard, Kyle, and Denisio, our South Mountain staff, for putting on the event with their community partners that you see listed above. So thank you to them and the entire powwow planning community for this amazing event. We look forward to it next year. Next slide, please. As Dr. Newton alluded to in her faculty presentation, staff and faculty have built a wonderful collaborative relationship. So in our staff presentation, we want to highlight a Rio faculty member, Dr. Jennifer Gresko, is named to the State Educator Retention Task Force that has been formed by Governor Katie Hobbs. She is the community college representative on this task force, and there is a link on our slide. So if you'd like to learn more about it, my apologies, I'm trying to The task force will be making recommendations regarding educator retention crisis in a report due in December 23rd. So they'll be taking on a variety of issues affecting retention, including pay and benefits, working conditions, and teacher preparation programs. So we're just grateful that our community college system has its own representative on this task force. So thank you to Dr. Gresko for taking on this role, and we look forward to the great work that's going to come from that committee. Next slide, please. So we try to highlight diversity celebrations every month in our presentation. In April, we're highlighting it as the month of the military child. They say military children are like dandelions. They can put down roots almost anywhere. They are impossible to destroy. They adapt easily and can survive nearly anywhere. Military families move every 2 to 3 years on average, and military children change schools average to 6 to 9 times from the start of kindergarten to their high school graduation. They sacrifice close relationships, sometimes even with immediate family members, due to the distances they live and the number of times they transfer. Military children are a unique group of people, not only while they're children, but while they become adults. So I highly encourage everyone to take a look at that link that we've shared on our slide and learn more about the military child and how we can help them as they become students in our system. Next slide, please. We want to give a shout out to the Maricopa Community Colleges Foundation for putting this together. They have put together an amazing scholarship application for our students. The scholarship deadline is April 30th. So faculty, staff, community members that are listening, please, please, please get your students, new incoming and returning students, to apply for the scholarship. This is a single scholarship application that will help you apply to multiple scholarships. Our community college district has over 600 scholarships available for fall 2023, and there is over $100,000 sometimes unawarded from these scholarships. Please fill out this application, get your tuition paid for, let us pay you to be a Maricopa student and to succeed. Amen. So please share this with all your students incoming. Next slide, please. We are here to highlight the representatives from Gateway Community College. Michelle Ray and Tiffany Wimbish are our non-exempt representatives. Terry Carroll and Patty Kirchner are exempt representatives, and Patty is your senator. Gateway, you are extremely lucky to have these group of representatives working for your campus. You have moved Gateway representation and shared governance forward, and Calvin and I are honored to work with you all. Next slide, please. As always, you can find our information here, and if you want to get a hold of us, thank you all very much.
Thank you. May I continue to call you Ms. Manje, or do I have to go with a hard G there?
Manje from now on.
You are a wise woman sometimes. That is, I mean, all the time. Okay, I'll stop talking. We're now moving to our Emeritus Awards. Tonight we have 7, and I will call them individually. Our first distinction goes to Mr. Peter Zawicki. Dr. Diaz?
Peter.
Just here for now. So President Sullivan, governing board members, Chancellor Gonzalez, members of CEC, and guests, it is my privilege to recognize Mr. Peter Zawicki with emeritus status from Gateway tonight. Allow me to share a few highlights from his career. He was the first program director for the then new physical therapy assisting program at Gateway in 1993 and has served continuously in that role until his retirement. He successfully led the PTA program through the initial programmatic accreditation in 1995 and subsequent reaffirmations in 2000, 2010, and 2020. He served as faculty senator, president-elect, and president of the Gateway Faculty Senate. And in fact, when I started at Gateway, Peter was the faculty senate president. He received multiple physical therapy assistant education and physical therapy practitioner awards from various professional organizations. He provided leadership to the Commission on Accreditation in Physical Therapy Education, known as CAPD, in many ways over his career, including serving as a site visitor. And he continued to stay current as a practitioner by working per diem as a staff physical therapist at Banner Boswell Hospital from 1993 until the present. Are you still doing that? Okay, good for you. His colleagues describe him as serious, professional, and a phenomenal mentor to them. In fact, he had a few of his colleagues as students in our PTA program at Gateway. They always noted that Peter received numerous thank you notes from students over the years. And they shared two pretty funny stories with me, Peter, so sorry about that. They said that he was able to demonstrate gait deviations to perfection. He would have the students parading through the halls trying to practice all of the deviations, and that the practice was important for student learning, but it also got many laughs from people passing in the hall, but that he was the best. He was the best at it. And one of the funniest things one of his colleagues witnessed was when he would teach falling and fall recovery, and he would demonstrate how to fall properly. He would fall straight down on the front of his body and land on his forearms, almost like a tree falling in the forest. The shock on the students' faces every time was priceless. And on a personal note, from my experiences with Peter, I can attest to his professionalism and how deeply he cares about students and their success in their chosen careers. But I've always appreciated how kind and supportive he was of me in the various roles I have had at Gateway. Every time I saw Peter, regardless of the reason, he asked me about me and my husband and wondered how we were doing in Arizona. I always enjoyed talking to him about his time spent in Chicago, partly while studying at UIC, and our fondness for Chicago sports teams, especially the Cubs. Finally, if you're wondering how he's doing in retirement, not even 1 month into it, I bumped into him volunteering at the TPC Waste Management Golf Tournament. So I'd say he's doing just fine, but let's hear directly from him. Peter.
Thank you, Dr. Diaz, for that introduction. President Sullivan, members of the governing board, Chancellor Gonzalez, and others. In 1992, Gateway Community College, with the support of the governing board of the Maricopa County Community Colleges, received approval to develop a physical therapy assistant educational program. At the time of its development, there were no other PTA education programs in Arizona. PTAs work under the direction and supervision of physical therapists to provide rehabilitation care to individuals recovering from a variety of physical injuries and medical conditions that affect the neuromuscular, cardiopulmonary, musculoskeletal, and integumentary systems of the body, including but not limited to those that have had strokes, traumatic brain injuries, multiple sclerosis, spinal cord injury, and orthopedic injuries, among others. The rehabilitation provided assists patients to regain function and mobility and minimize or eliminate pain to allow individuals to reach their highest level of physical performance. I was hired in January 1993 as the program director of the new program, and the program has been fully accredited by the Commission on Accreditation of Physical Therapy Education since 1995. Over the next 30 years, it has been my great good fortune to work with many talented and dedicated faculty who provided the highest quality of education to students in the program. Full-time faculty included Kirsten Burdahl, Debbie Bornman, Jessica Goodman, Laura Safa, Tony DeLeon, and James Washington. There have also been numerous students, adjunct faculty, and clinical instructors who have supported the education of the students. In addition to the faculty support, support has been provided by college administrators and dedicated personnel in various student support services, including advising, financial aid, admissions, and counseling. In my work, I've also had the faithful support of my wife, Linda, who is here with us tonight, as well as my two sons, Stephen and David. I could not have been effective in my work without their love and support. I am very appreciative of the administration at Gateway for providing ongoing support of the program through the years, including the development of a hybrid weekend expansion program in 2005, in which students completed requirements through online lecture courses, as well as lab-based courses that were conducted over long weekends. This program expansion allowed many students to achieve their goal of becoming a PTA that otherwise would not have been possible. The program has had more than 1,000 graduates who are effectively providing care and service to their patients in the practice of physical therapy, and the program is highly respected in the community. Program graduates work in hospitals, skilled nursing facilities, outpatient physical therapy practices, and other practice settings. I am hopeful that in some small way, I have contributed to their success of the program and of the graduates as they proceed to work in this career field. I will always treasure my work as faculty at Gateway and the many positive relationships that I have had with students, graduates, faculty, administrators, clinical instructors, and all those who have contributed to the success of the program and graduates. Thank you for this recognition as faculty emeritus at Gateway Community College. Thank you.
It's my honor to give you this certificate.
Thank you very much.
Congratulations.
Thank you.
There are many of us in this room who have benefited from great physical therapy. There are several of us as board members. In fact, one of the hand therapists I have has been a graduate. So thank you for that. It's wonderful. All right, moving on. We also now have Dr. Bonnie Gray. Dr. Lisinski.
President Sullivan, governing board members, Chancellor Gonzalez, CEC colleagues, and guests. If I may have this privilege, the next six are actually all from Scottsdale Community College. So
if,
go for it. All right, I will definitely go for it. So at SEC, we've had somewhat of a break in our faculty emeritus awards. And so we wanted to make sure that before the academic year came to conclusion that we did our due diligence and honored some amazing faculty members who contributed significantly to the betterment of Scottsdale Community College, but also to the betterment of Maricopa Community College District. Four of our six are here this evening, but I'm first gonna begin with two who are unable to attend. And we are gonna host a celebration early in the fall. We're gonna invite our faculty emeriti from past and the current to join us for a celebration on campus as well, so we can celebrate them in person. But first I'd like to recognize Mr. Sirio Calagero. During his tenure at Maricopa, Professor Calagero devoted his time and limitless energy to delivering high quality instruction, promoting multiculturalism and inclusiveness through student activities, and serving our campus community. Mr. Calagero taught the entire Italian language course sequence, developed an Italian humanities course, and earned an Innovation of the Year in 2015 for implementing a high flex course format, so maybe innovative for his time then. He also served as a faculty advisor to students, mentored new faculty, and coordinated a study abroad program to Rome. We appreciate his countless exceptional contribution to Scottsdale students and campus life, his 12 years of adjunct teaching for Maricopa, and his 18 years as residential faculty for Scottsdale. Let's have a round of applause, please, for Mr. Calagero. Our next award is to Bonnie Gray, who is psychology faculty at SCC. Dr. Gray has been an extremely productive and dedicated faculty member for over 35 years and has made numerous significant contributions that have bettered and improved her students, the college, and the district. There were many accomplishments noted in the nomination form for this. I'm just going to highlight a few this evening. She was the creator and executive director of the Diversity Infusion Program for Maricopa. This was a model for diversity, equity, and inclusion, inclusion education, both nationally and internationally, and more than 180 different courses representing more than 61 different course prefixes were infused with diversity by over 200 faculty who participated in the program. Additionally, she was the creator of perspective forums for Maricopa. These forums provided opportunities for staff, students, and community to explore important and frequently controversial issues in a respectful and engaging manner. Additionally, she was nominated twice for Innovator of the Year Award. She was the Behavioral Sciences Department Chair at our college. And she did some work additionally with ASU, with an undergraduate psychology students. We're able to work together with graduate psychology students from ASU to learn about and to conduct research for publication and paper presentations. Let's have a nice round of applause for Bonnie Gray as well. And now the remaining four emeriti are actually here tonight. So I'm gonna introduce our first two are actually, I'm gonna bring up together. I think you will understand why. So first, Ms. Sandra Desjardins. And then following that will be Robert Mugford. So Sandra and Robert, please come forward now. Thank you. So first for Sandra, she not only taught English humanities and creative writing and composition, but she broke new ground with student-focused creative writing programming and publications. She also served as a regional leader for the Community College Humanities Association and served as program chair for the association conference when Maricopa hosted it. Her greatest legacies include SCC's annual creative writing and art contest and the resulting award-winning student art and creative writing journal called The Vortex. And we actually have the Vortex celebration coming up. It's either tomorrow or Thursday evening. She also initiated Retro Muse, an open mic event for creative writing and music students. Her passion for students' artistic and self-expression still inspires our programming today. And now I think you'll understand the connection. Sandra, along with her husband, Robert Mugford, founded an emergency scholarship, further reflecting their commitment to Scottsdale students. So with that, I'd also like to introduce Robert, who served as SEC English faculty, dedicated to advancing students' academic composition skills. Throughout his tenure, he worked to elevate all students' writing and critical thinking skills, but especially those who enter college needing additional writing coursework in preparation for academic college English. He also supported his students at campus events and through scholarships. Mr. Mugford's authenticity and kindness of spirit as he coached students towards success while they overcame challenges to their academic progress remained constant throughout his career and left significant impact on his students. Let's have a round of applause, and we're going to give the mic to both Sandra and Robert.
Thank you. Welcome to all of you who are here listening to us tonight. I appreciate it. President Sullivan, what grade would you give him on the pronunciation of my name?
Sure. Whoa. Maybe a B?
He better stay.
No, I would say you did okay.
You did okay. Thank you. Sorry to put you on the spot. Members of the board, Chancellor Gonzalez, and members of the CEC, thank you for this tonight. I want you to know how grateful I am that I was hired by Maricopa College as a very long time ago. I had no idea when I was hired how much I could learn academically and personally until I began teaching. And teaching is a lot like marriage. You have to be seen in every kind of light. You know, the really bad teachers are the sages on the stage, you know, that type. But if you are really worth your salt as a teacher, you've got to be in touch with yourself and know when you lose the class or even one student. So that growing experience is invaluable. I had so many opportunities to imagine what would be good for students. What would they like? What could they benefit from? And then once I imagined that, I could say, why not? So find a way to go ahead and create those programs, classes, opportunities for students, whether they were local or national. I've worked on some of those too, and it has been the joy of my life. But speaking of that, the bigger joy is I want to also thank Maricopa Colleges for allowing me to meet the person who would become my husband, Robert Mugford. I was working part-time at Scottsdale, part-time at Mesa, and part-time at ASU. I had just come back after my second graduate degree, and I didn't know what I was doing. And we ran into each other, and the rest was history. But over 30 years of carpooling, teaching the same subject, seeing each other almost 24 hours a day, and we're still married and loving it. Any project, any project I wanted to take on, he was right there. They say every pilot needs a co-pilot. We worked great together and we enjoyed, we had so much fun doing everything together. We even team taught together, enjoyed that. Funny story, a young woman came to my office one day. I had her in my class and she was also in Robert's class. She didn't know that we were married because we have different names, you know, whatever. She comes in and closes my office door and she says, I've got to tell you something really serious. It's a legal matter. I said, okay, what is that? And she says, the professor next door to you, I think he's stalking you. And I said, you know, I've kind of felt that too. But what makes you think that? And she goes, it's creepy. I mean, it's creepy. He has pictures of you all over his office. But anyway, we've had a good time together and it's an honor to be here tonight. And thanks for the memories.
I yielded my time to her. You can see why.
Thank you.
Thank you.
So again, on behalf of Scottsdale Community College and to the, I'm from the Maricopa Community College District. Congratulations on your faculty emeritus distinction.
Thank you so much.
Okay, and the artichoke show continues. Next, I'd like to ask Susan Moore to please come forward. Personal note, Susan's one of the first faculty members that I actually had a chance to work with when I came to Maricopa about 19 years ago. And she was always kind, warm, supportive, and helped me become a better leader when I was at the MCLI. So thank you for that. So Susan's leadership at all levels of the institution supported innovative efforts to develop faculty programs, provide professional mentorship to faculty, and promote excellence in teaching and student learning. She led the new faculty onboarding effort by initiating the new faculty experience and by creating the peer assistance and training program, both programs now well embedded within our culture at SCC. In recognition of these efforts, she was awarded SCC's Faculty of the Year in 2015. Whether serving as division chair or supporting the dual enrollment instructors, acting as Scottsdale's travel committee representatives, or in her role as new faculty experience developer and leader, Susan left a lasting legacy of innovative programming, excellent teaching, and faculty mentorship with her students and colleagues at SCC. Susan Moore.
Thank you. Board members, chancellor, college presidents, guests. I feel very humbled and honored to be standing with such esteemed colleagues. When I got hired in 1993, I remember distinctly thinking, I am so lucky I landed this job. But what I couldn't have imagined back when I was young and had dark hair, that it, of all the gifts that this job would provide for me over 30 years, gifts such as colleagues who would become lifelong friends, who attended weddings, baptisms, funerals. We did it together and celebrated the joys and sorrows of our families as a family. Gifts such as leaders who inspired and encouraged, and most importantly, supported me to stretch my own leadership legs, as my former VPA, Daniel Kaur, would say. And most importantly, students who taught me hundreds of lessons about what was good teaching and what was not, about fortitude, resilience, and courage. Students like Abigail Johnson, who came to my class after having suffered a terrible car accident her senior year in high school that left her paraplegic. She went on to write 7 young adult novels published by Penguin Random House, and she typed those with her knuckles. Students such as Ryan, who came to class with terrible PTSD after having served in Afghanistan, who through the support of faculty and staff found his purpose in counseling other veterans. Students such as Dr. Jack McDougall, who came to my class and he was a retired physician. He was 80 years old and just wanted to learn how to write his memoirs. And he sent me a Christmas card every year for the next 10 years until he died. And students like Patty, who came. She was a mom of 3, and she had come to my class just having received a transplanted heart. And during the end, at the end of that semester, her heart failed, and the entire class attended her funeral holding hands. And I remember thinking, who gets to do this? Who gets to witness human connection so up close? So again, the work being done at these colleges is life-changing. I am but one of hundreds of faculty members, and these are just 4 of tens of thousands of students. And it has been a privilege, and it is a gift. And I just hope that this board continues to treasure that gift and protect it. So thank you.
So on behalf of Scottsdale Community College and the Maricopa Community Colleges, congratulations, Susan. And last but not least, Susan Peterson, if you would please come forward. Susan served with distinction as a faculty member at Scottsdale. She was an outstanding instructor, as evidenced by evaluations from her students and supervisors. She was committed to student success and dedicated to constant improvement and innovation in her teaching. She developed the International Business Program and was instrumental in the creation of the Business Fast Track Program. You won several awards, including Business Division Faculty of the Year, Woman of Distinction, and the Scottsdale Innovation of the Year Award as well. She was not only an exemplary faculty member, but also spent most of her career in various service and leadership positions, a student advisor at Scottsdale, program director for international business, business department evening chair, business department day chair, the business and CIS division chair, interim dean of instruction, co-chair of Scottsdale's Guided Pathways Initiative, and served on the district business instructional council. Susan Peterson.
Thank you. I'd like to recognize Dr. Lushinsky for having an A plus in pronouncing my name. So I just want to put that out there. President Sullivan, members of the board, Dr. Gonzalez, members of the CEC, and guests. I'm deeply honored to receive the Emeritus Distinction for my 26 years of service as faculty in the business department at Scottsdale Community College. When I earned my MBA in the greed is good 1980s, my goal was to make as much money as possible. I'll just be quite honest with you. And while life in the business world was exciting, I felt a little bit hollow inside. So I couldn't really continue that route. And so I decided to develop a hobby in the early 1990s, and I started teaching part-time just for fun. And what I learned is that that was actually my true calling, and that's where I wanted to be. So I left my job in industry and pursued a full-time career in higher education. As Dr. Lushinsky said, during my tenure, I had the pleasure of teaching three generations of college students, ranging from Generation X, that were only a few years older than I was, to Millennials, to Generation Z, which is actually the generation of my own children. I also had the honor of serving in several leadership positions, which I won't name since he already named that. And I want you to know that, yes, I am a glutton for punishment. So people kept electing me, and I wanted to serve, and I really was honored to be able to represent them. What truly made my time at SCC special, though, was the camaraderie and support of the entire college community. It makes your heart full to be able to count on the people that you work with, not only as colleagues, but as true friends as well. As I conclude my professional journey, I want to express my gratitude to everyone who helped me along the way. I want to thank SEC's superb administration, my fellow division chairs, the Business and Information Systems Division, the Business Department, and my family, especially the gentleman who is in the corner videotaping me right now, my husband Damon, who supported my decision to pursue this crazy career called higher education. Once again, I'm deeply honored to receive this distinction, and I'm grateful to have had the opportunity to serve the SEC community. Thank you.
And Susan, again, on behalf of Scottsdale and Maricopa, congratulations on this
distinction. Thank you very much. Thank you.
Thank you so much, everyone.
You're welcome. You know, it's interesting having students and then all the presentations and concluding with the Emeritus Awards in this regard, this part of our board meeting, reminds me that we are about teaching and learning. So to all of you presented reports, our employee group, our adjunct group, our faculty group, our students tonight, our emeritus, let's just celebrate everybody again. And moving on to another, Dr. Gonzalez, you've been quite celebrated in the last few weeks. I mean, by us, oh, every day. Okay. but certainly, I was going to mention it later, but we were able to have you honored at the reception this past week at the Helios Foundation, sponsored by them and our foundation. They recognized you for your leadership to higher learning and institutions, higher learning institutions, and certainly the position you hold in our county. So celebrating you, we do this often.
Well, thank you.
Anyway, so Dr. Gonzalez, getting back to script, we're ready for your report.
Okay. President Sullivan, members of the board, CEC, and guests that are with us this evening, we are in a teaching and learning business, and we're also, as one of the faculty members being honored here this evening said, we're in a life-changing business too. We're in a life-changing business, and guess what? Business is good. So this is a wonderful place to work for. So there was also mentioned earlier of the fact that we've got students that are with us that grew up in a military household and spent much of their lives moving around the country and the world. And that happens to be one of our student trustees, or our student trustee. Lynn's has shared some really interesting stories as a military child. Maybe one of these days you should ask him, because they're funny. He learned a lot of life lessons on other parts of the world that he is using here today that work just as well in the United States, right, Lynn? So on to my chancellor's report. This is a really exciting time of the year. It's fast-paced, fast-moving, but it's the time when we get to celebrate the great work, the time and energy that our students put in, that our faculty and staff and our administration put into making sure that our students cross that finish line. So we have a number of convocations, we have a number of commencements, and please attend those. And as I encourage folks at CEC today, these are things that we get to celebrate together. It's the fruit of our labor, it's the fruit of their labor, and just pause in that moment. Forget about all of the harsh realities around the world that are going on here in Maricopa and state and so forth, and just enjoy that pleasurable moment. So be sure that you you attend one and you know, raise the roof for those students. Let me give you a quick enrollment update as we're heading into the summer and spring semester is coming to a fast end. Our headcount is up about 7.2% over this time last year. And as we're preparing for the fall 2023 semester, our headcount is up almost just under 4%. So we continue to see a steady incline back to the numbers that we once had. And then there's the excitement around the bachelor's degree, and that buzz continues. We currently have 285 students who are actually enrolled in one of our 7 bachelor's degrees throughout the district. That's nearly 300 students who this time last year didn't know what they were going to be doing, but now they know that they're going to start a bachelor's degree in Maricopa. So that's really exciting. We have what we call 1,030 entering students, and 687 of those are ready to enroll. So we'll keep working that number. And as we start the fall semester, hopefully 285 becomes 585 and 1085 and so forth. I'm throwing out goals to people and they're writing these things down. Really happy to report an update. As you all may recall, we had a BASH event, which is the Be a Student Hero, that is led by Ryan Spicker, the foundation, and his team. And it was a one-day opportunity for all of us as employees to be a student hero by reaching into our pockets and contributing to that effort so that more scholarship monies were available for these students who were struggling to pay for school and needed that extra dollar that this would provide. So happy to report that between 334 generous supporters, we raised $170,345, which is a 33.2% revenue increase over last year, which means that that was an average gift amount totaling $477 per person, a 73.4% increase over this time last year. Listen to this, faculty and staff accounted for 65% of the donations, which leveraged by matching gifts from 23 donors and sponsors. So as you know, these funds are going to be provided to support the students. So I want to say thank you, and I'm sure Brian would say the same, but thank you for reaching your pockets and reinvesting in the organization that you work for. So thank you. Give yourself a hand for that. The foundation is engaging in a 3-year strategic plan. I'm sure that you will be reached out to and provided an opportunity to engage in that process. So be looking out for an email or an invitation to complete a survey, possibly attend an interview or a focus group. And one more item related to the foundation, it's been a busy part of the organization, but they had the first celebration in several years to honor those donors that have committed large amounts of dollars to the institution in support of our students. And in this room, we had maybe 30, 40 major donors, Brian, and along with students. And it was just a really nice celebration. I had an opportunity to get around to each table and speak with most of the donors. And it is really, really fascinating to discover why they've decided to be a donor to Maricopa to give the students. It is almost always tied to someone who has passed away, who was a former employee of the system, who was a former student, or who just had a love for education. And so we're just honored to be a part and to be the recipients of that generosity through our community. So I really thank the foundation. And again, and I thank everybody for being a part of that. And then finally, a legislative update. This current session has passed the 100th day and is resuming work after a recess to renew and to focus on budget negotiations. So, of course, our priorities remain on expenditure limitation relief. Seeing if Kim has any unusual faces to make there. Our dual enrollment expansion bill are both making progress as part of the budget process. And then through budget negotiations, there seems to be developing constructively that it'll happen in weeks, if not months away. And our government relation team continues to work with AC4 to develop a long-term plan to address the community college or expenditure limitation. Maricopa participated in a meeting with K-12 superintendents to compare strategies on the expenditure limitation, and AC4 also issued its report on strategies recommended by our community college business officers throughout the state, and the priority of which is pursuing short-term relief to allow to seek a ballot-focused strategy potentially in the future. And I too want to thank Dr. Newton for being a leader this past year. I know this is the time of year when our employee leaders begin to roll off and others come on. And Camille, it's been a pleasure working with you. We've worked through some really difficult issues, but we had a lot of fun and we got to work on more fun than I think the things that were maybe not as fun. So that's a good sign. So thank you so much for that work. And then, you know, as I heard the students present on South Mountain, burritos with the president. I had, when I was at Gateway, I had pizza with the president, but I'm not going to be outdone by burritos with president. So I'm thinking about churros with the chancellor. How's that? Can I get you? All right. Thank you.
That concludes my report. Thank you, Dr. Gonzalez. When are you holding that?
We can do it right after this if you'd like.
Do you have them in your back pocket? Okay, he's kidding, I guess. We'll look forward to that, though. Thank you. All right, moving on. We have citizens interim, but I have no requests for citizens interim this evening. Ms. Macias, is that correct? Thank you. Okay, so we're now moving on to consideration of consent agenda items. All items under the section of the agenda are consent matters unless they're removed from the consent agenda at this time. Do any board members or you, Dr. Gonzalez, wish to remove any items from the consent agenda? Hearing none, is there a motion to approve the consent agenda? Thank you. Is there a second?
Second.
Thank you. We have a motion on the floor for approving the consent agenda as presented. All in favor, please vote by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? By a vote of 7-0, and also including our student trustee, the consent agenda is approved. And then board members, before you leave, I do need you as a result of that to sign a Gateway Early College High School revised budget. So don't leave unless you've done that, please. All right, I'm now moving on to non-consent action items. The first item for approval is approval of resolution of the Maricopa County Community Colleges District Governing Board, directing the chancellor to prepare a resolution to pursue a ballot measure in 2024 regarding the Maricopa Community College District's expenditure limitation. I'd like to move to a motion, but before I do, are there any questions? Ms. Granillo, we certainly have understood your presentations these many years, and more recently. So thank you. So with that, is there a motion to approve the resolution as stated?
President?
Yes, Ms. Bittersmith?
I would so move with just a couple of brief comments. I think all of us in the room, but for those that may be listening, understand this is an opportunity for us to continue to explore this option, look at opportunities, challenges, support levels, and maybe some miracle that's hanging in the sky we don't know about that might fix this problem without having to do that. But understanding this is an opportunity for us to do this appropriate research and deliberation to take what could potentially be a final step to go to a ballot issue. And so with that, I would so move the adoption of the resolution.
Thank you. Is there a second?
Second.
Thank you, Dr. Thor. Any discussion on the motion as presented, board members? Guess we really understand you, Ms. Grineo. So with that, is there, I'm going to call roll call vote, starting with the student trustee. Mr. Burnett, do you have a point of view on this?
No comments.
And will you vote yay or nay? You vote
yay.
Thank you. Then Ms. Bittersmith?
Aye.
Thank you. Ms. Butler? Thank you. Ms. Davis?
Aye.
Thank you. Dr. Nerini?
Aye.
Thank you. Ms. Smith?
Aye.
Thank you, Dr. Thor. And I vote aye. So the resolution passes with all board members voting aye, including our student trustee. Thank you. This is a very serious issue, and we really appreciate Dr. Gonzalez, you moving forward to do the research, lead that, so that we can understand our next steps and where we will go further. I understand you will have a lot of team help in doing that. Thank you. Moving on then to the second read and approval of the proposed fiscal year 23-24 residential faculty agreement effective July 1, 2023. Do I have a motion to approve the proposed residential faculty agreement effective that date?
So moved.
Thank you, Dr. Nerini. Do I have a second?
Second.
Thank you, Dr. Thor. Any discussion on the motion? Being
President,
none.
White President Sullivan, yes, I would just like to commend the Dr. Newton and everybody else who worked on this. This is an extensive project, and I'm glad it was you guys and not me. So thank you.
We understand there is a tremendous amount of work that goes into this, so thank you. And I just want to acknowledge that there may not be discussion from board members, but that's because they were well studied and because of the presentations that have been done throughout the year. So with that, I'm going to ask a vote on the motion. All those in favor, please vote by saying aye, and that includes our student trustee.
Aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? The motion carries 7-0 with our student trustee always in support. Thank you. We now move to item number 3, approval of 2 additional memorandums of understanding for the 22-23 faculty agreement, one regarding workload limits and summer supervision in summer 23, and 2 course load calculations. Do I have a motion to approve the 2 additional MOUs as stated?
So moved.
Thank you, Ms. Davis. Do I have a second?
Second.
Thank you, Dr. Nerini. Is there any discussion on the motion? Being none, again, I will call for an aye vote or nay. All in favor, please vote by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? The motion carries 7-0 with our student trustee also voting aye. Thank you. So that takes care of our agenda for the evening of non-consent items. Moving on, we're now at first read of information items. The first item is employment and separations for February 18, 2023 through March 17, 23. Are there any questions? No comments, no questions. Next one, first read of proposed fiscal year 24 budget for Maricopa County Community College District. Are there any comments or questions? Okay, then we're moving on to the first read of governing board policy changes to Dr. Thor. I'm going to read them all. outcomes for one policy number one, global lands broadest outcome. 1.1, university transfer education and general education. 1.2, workforce and economic development. 1.3, developmental education. 1.4, community development and civic and global engagement. And 4.1, governing values. Dr. Thor, just could you give the audience a brief explanation of what we're doing with these policies before I ask for any comments or questions?
Thank you. I'd be happy to. So this action brings the governing board policies into alignment with the new strategic plan that was just developed. So what used to be outcomes are now the strategic priorities. And also 4.1 governing values is the old mission, vision, and values. And this action would bring it forward to section one, where it more appropriately fits along with the other components of the strategic plan.
Thank you, Dr. Thor. Board members, do you have any further comments or questions? Being none, then we do have a budget analyst's report fund on fund one, general unrestricted fund for the 9 months ending March 31st, 2023. Do you have any comments or questions? Being none, I'm now going to move to our community linkage reports. I'm going to start with you, Mr. Burnett, and also acknowledge that you have been selected to serve one more term on the governing board as the student representative. So congratulations. So beyond that, do you have anything to report?
Yeah, just a brief report, President Sullivan. Once the President Sullivan endorsed me running again, they stopped taking applications. So I guess she's got a lot more power than I thought. Attended the Senate meetings. We had a little change up in the Student Senate, and I think you're gonna, for those of you who are interested in what's going on in the Student Senate activity, I think you're gonna see a lot more production, productivity, and effectiveness in the next 3 months than probably in the last nine. One of my goals is to make sure that we get those senators doing this meeting in person. They've been virtual all year, and it's time that we started pressing the flesh and giving each other hugs and looking in each other's eyes and talking. That's important. So they have a little bit of a COVID hangover, but I think we're gonna fix that starting in the next fiscal year. So 321 and 411 attended those meetings. Obviously, the board meetings that we have here in our virtual meetings, attended the AGB conference with Dr. Narini and President Sullivan and Ms. Bittersmith, and they made me spend a lot of money that I didn't have. I'm a student. I thought they would take that into consideration, but we had a great time. It was the most educational. I wish I had done that at the very beginning of my term. It's a great thing for a student representative to the governing board to attend that at the very beginning. But knowing that I'll be here next year, I'm going to take what I've learned from there and understanding what the position is and what it represents to not only the board, but the CEC and the chancellor and the entire student body of all 10 colleges. It was very, very valuable to attend that. And I appreciate President Sullivan inviting me to attend that conference. It was fantastic. And the weather wasn't bad either. Attended the town halls, the last one with President or with the chancellor, Chancellor Gonzalez. It was exciting. I ended up coming down with something at the very end of it and couldn't do the last one, but again, just like the one we did at South Mountain or Australia Mountain, the one at Phoenix College, very interesting, great students, intelligent, passionate, and the communication between the chancellor and the student body was unadulterated. It was very forthright, the questions that were asked and answered. You guys see the chancellor in a different light than the students do, and I can tell you that not only is he a very, very effective communicator, but he connects. He just doesn't talk, he connects. And it was phenomenal to see that. I look forward to the last one we're going to do, which is virtual. And if you have an opportunity to get around students as they're talking to faculty members, I think it's great. I think as I get around your presidents, I realize the most fun you ever have is when you're not in the office, is when you're out there talking to students and videoing them and having interactions with them and asking them where they're from, what they're studying. It's the blessing of your job. And I think the presidents do a great job, and the chancellor does a fantastic job at that. I would do those anytime. Again, re-election with the next year, so I'll be here for another term. I think maybe two is my limit. I don't want to compete with the president. She's got four terms, so I think two is where I'll stop. But I've definitely enjoyed last year. I think next year is going to be even more exciting. And I did the last thing I did was a coffee talk. I attended the chancellor's reception. That's that right after we did that town hall. I went to the chancellor's reception, but I didn't get a chance to stay the whole time. I was obviously coming down with something. But the 40X talk, the coffee talk, I plugged into too. And I looked at the list of attendees. I think there were 400 people on that coffee talk. That's like a big coffee shop. And they were talking about 4DX, and I was almost embarrassed to say I had no idea what 4DX was. But I listened to the questions and I listened to the interaction, and it was good. I just didn't understand what 4DX was, so I'm Googling it the whole time. And by the end of it, I finally realized what the initiative was. But it was interesting just to see the interaction. More than me being a part of it, I was just learning from it, so it was good. So that's my report. That concludes my report, President Sullivan.
Thank you very much. And I'm just going to go down the list here. So Ms. Smith.
Thank you. So I'm looking forward next month to attend the Chandler Gilbert Community College graduation. I'll have my tissues ready for that. And I just wanted to say I'll be missing the adjunct faculty award, but thank you for the invitation this week. And I'll be missing some of the convocations this year. My cousin's getting married in Boston, and then we'll spend a few extra days. My family's all based on the East Coast, so I'll be there with them. But I hope the convocations go really well. I really appreciate the themes that are being celebrated and the work that goes into them. And I'll see some of my colleagues at graduation. Best of luck at the end of the semester. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Ms. Smith. Ms. Davis?
So I don't want to steal this away from Dr. Norini. We visited Gateway's beauty and wellness program, and where's Nick? Okay, and it was wonderful. I learned a lot. I'm sure all of us did. So it still didn't get me to wear lipstick, apparently, but we had a great time, and we learned a lot. I went to Chancellor Gonzalez reception at my home base of Helios Education Foundation, because that's where I work when I go to work. I usually work from home, but the reception I thought was really very, very nice. I was pleased with that. Last week we attended the AACCT conference, and I thought the sessions there were amazing. I learned so much. We had somebody from the Student Clearinghouse. We had a speaker about the Great Upheaval, who wrote a book, Scott Van Pelt, and somebody Levine. Is that his name, I think? Yeah. And all of the speak, and somebody about certification.
What is it called?
Yeah, accreditation.
Tom something.
Yeah, Tom something. But it was, but the speakers were good, and I learned a lot. And then last Friday, Kelly and I visited Scottsdale Community College, and I hardly asked any questions, so that was a good thing. And we went to see the Performing Arts Center, where they were going to be performing Rent. And it said Rent in the schedule, and I thought it was the name of a building. I told the President Leshinsky, oh, I thought Rent was the name of a building. But it was very nice to talk with the students, because they were getting ready to do a production pretty soon that day, because they had high school students coming over to see the production. We visited the wildlife area, and we visited with some Be Kind students who ended up accompanying us on the rest of our tours. So it was a great day, and I appreciate your hosting us, President Leshinsky. I guess that's it. I would like to attend the Adjunct Faculty Awards, but I'm going to have to be late. So I don't know whether that's a good thing or not. And Paul's not here, so. And I'm done.
Thank you, Ms. Bittersmith.
Thank you, President Sullivan. Well, as Mr. Burnett mentioned, several of us attended the Association of Governing Boards conference a few weeks ago. We did more than lead the student trustee astray on dining options. In fact, I thought it was very useful because this is obviously a combination of community college board trustees, but also university trustees. And given our entry into the baccalaureate degree space, it was helpful for me to get a sense of challenges, the political aspects of providing those degrees. I found it very, very interesting and very useful. And I think it's an opportunity for some of us to go on an annual basis for that purpose. As previously mentioned, many of us were at the AACCT meeting. I just want to thank Dr. Borowski for putting a lot of that together. I thought it was useful for us to have conversations collectively with our fellow trustees from the rest of the state, dealing with what we just talked about earlier, our EL challenges uniformly, but also the other political challenges that are not just to Maricopa, but other districts. I then joined last weekend. Dr. Lashinsky graciously invited me to join a ceremony at SCC that was a recognition of the Armenian genocide. There's a memorial that, as many times I've been on that campus, I did not know that memorial was there, but now we do. It was a number of Armenian based or related educators talking about these issues, and it was a nice ceremony, so I appreciate being included. The final thing is, please put on your calendar November 16th. As we move on to the end of the year, that is the Foundation Gala event at the Phoenix Art Museum. I'm honored to be a part of doing that. Obviously, the heavy lifting is coming from our foundation staff and the foundation board, but this is a chance to do all the kinds of things we've been talking about with scholarships, raising money, and I promise you it is not going to be a boring sit-down dinner. The museum allows us the opportunity to wander through the galleries. There will be entertainments from our students. We've heard some of that in the last couple of meetings. There's an opportunity at all levels of participation, and you will not have to eat a chicken dinner. It will be fun and a way of supporting what we do, our students, with some financial services.
Oh, wonderful. Thank you, Ms. Bittersmith. Okay, November 16th. When is Thanksgiving, the following week?
It's after that, so you can still eat.
Okay, good. Thank you. Ms. Butler.
Thank you. Well, much of my tour of the colleges is along with Donna Davis, so some of that is repetitive, but really enjoyed going to Gateway to see the beauty and wellness program, and just the thought that people in the community can come and get services there, and for a really, really reduced price. And it just was a very nice atmosphere, obviously very dedicated staff and faculty there. Went to Glendale Community College and we talked to them about their 40X goals. We spent a lot of time with their leadership team. We had already toured the college, so we just sat and just talked about their baccalaureate programs that they're going to be offering and how hard they're working to get those up and running. I got to have two visits to Scottsdale Community College. One was to Dr. Lashinsky and his team put together this 40X goals mini golf situation. It was 9 holes, and Chancellor Gonzalez and I happened to be there, and we golfed together through these mini golf holes. And so they would talk about their 40X goals and progress as you were kind of completing this golfing. It was harder than it should have been. Dr. Gonzalez did way better than I did, but it was a really neat, creative, fun community. It really was such a fun community at SCC, celebrating their success, and was super memorable. Also attended the AACCT meeting, and also I am on the foundation board and working on the Heroes of Education Gala coming up in November. So really, really put that on your calendar. And it's just been so much fun to get around to the colleges. We're looking forward to more at the end of the week. And it's just an exciting time and looking forward to commencements and all of these, the great activities that are coming up. So thanks.
Thank you, Dr. Nerini.
Thank you. Let's see. I too went to the AGB conference. It was lots of fun, lots of good information. Won't talk about Tijuana, but that's something else. But on April 10th, I too went to the beauty and wellness program and put a plug in for the massage therapy. They're having their sessions, get massages at a reduced rate. So sign up now. But on the also on the 10th, I did the, attended here the foundation's honor scholarship reception. And Dr. Gonzalez talked about we're in the life-changing business. If you have come to that reception, it's not that we're just changing students' lives, we're changing families' lives. You see these individuals, you see these students, and you see their parents and their siblings and their children at this ceremony, getting these awards, being recognized, and you see that we're really changing families' generational lives with what we do. So that's what's so exciting about the honor scholarship reception. I attended online the ACCT Online Pacific Region meeting on the 13th. I also was able to be at the chancellor's reception at Helios on the 13th. And this must be Scottsdale's night, because on Scottsdale on the 18th, I was at the Artists of Promise program at Scottsdale Community College, where we get to see, listen to some short stories, some poetry, some theater. And it was, we have a lot of talent in this district, not just a faculty as well. You guys do a good job of molding that talent. So thank you for that. That's my report.
Thank you, Dr. Thor.
Thank you. This is the time of year that board members spend a lot of time together. So there's a lot of redundancy in our reports. On March 30th, I joined President Sullivan and Ms. Davis at the staff representation joint council at Phoenix College that was referenced earlier. And this was the second year that President Sullivan and I have been able to meet with the group. And I believe it was informative for all involved, informative for the staff representation members and informative for the board members as well. On April 12th, I joined President Sullivan and Ms. Bittersmith at Mayor Kate Gallego's State of the City address, where the mayor gave some really nice shout outs to the Maricopa community colleges. On April 13th, along with many others, I attended the reception for the chancellor at the Helios Foundation that was co-sponsored by our foundation. And it was wonderful to see so many community supporters there. Finally, on April 19th and 20th, I also went to the Arizona Association of Community College Trustees, all trustees meetings. And my thanks and compliments to Dr. Borofsky as well. It was a truly valuable program with excellent speakers. And we look forward to making this an annual event. I also will be participating in a number of the convocations and Rio Salado College's commencement. And that's always a very special time for all of us. And then I want to acknowledge that this is the last governing board meeting before the end of faculty accountability for the year. So for those faculty members that will be taking the summer off, I hope you have a very enjoyable, healthy, and happy break, and we'll see you back in the fall.
Thank you, Dr. Thor. Well, I can say six people gave my report in different modules. But just for the record, I would like to say, as we went through the business of the district, we kind of went through it really quickly, as I said at one point. And I believe what we're planning, Dr. Gonzalez, we've talked about this, that during our information sessions next time, or as I think when we reconvene in August, we're planning to put more conversation in around progress around strategic planning and different things. So we can all talk together a little differently, certainly under the board purview. But the reason I mention this is we're not about just attending galas and receptions and drinking fine wine and going to Tijuana in the middle of the night. Oh, sorry, I wasn't supposed to say that, Dr. Nerini. We didn't go with him, by the way. All right. I don't know who went with you, but that's another story. Yeah, you did. You were able to return. We were really grateful for that because you're a good participant at the AGB conference. But anyway, the reason I say that is because, again, board members behind the scenes are doing a lot of conversations with people that can teach us more. Well, the reason we're attending conferences and doing other things is because we take our professional development quite seriously. Our intention is to be good leaders, to bring ideas and thoughts to the table, but also to reflect the learning we get from you into other situations. And as we were attending, for example, the AGB Association of Governing Board Conference, I had the opportunity to sit with the Council of Board Chairs. I've been serving on that for 2 years, four years now. And one of the center of that conversation was what's under threat for higher institutions of learning, and to sit there and really have opportunities to learn and participate and anticipate with other governing board members from around the country. It is really an honor. And attending the sessions there was very interesting as well. There was always a learning, you know, whether it's around new trends that are already happening here where we get to say, wow, we're doing great. Or there are other opportunities where we can say, oh, we can bring that back and have discussions together and with Dr. Gonzalez. I think that's really important. So again, if you see us move quickly through some of those really important items, it's not because we're not studied. It's not because we haven't done homework. It's because we do take our job seriously. When it comes to the point of finally taking a vote, it's because we know what we're doing. I would like to say that on behalf of all of my colleagues. So with that, let me give you my list. I did also go to the staff representation, and thank you, Dr. Thor, for explaining how important that was, and appreciate both Ms. Mange and Mr. Duval hosting us for that. I attended, as stated, the Association Governing Board Conference. It was good. We did stumble into some fine restaurants, which we all paid for, by the way, by ourselves. We did go to, I also attended the AACC-TAC4 conference. Dr. Borowski's in the audience with us this evening, and I know all of us as board members have acknowledged your leadership to that conference, but also he, as many of you know, have led our CEC board retreats combination when we're doing strategic planning. So we really appreciate your contributions and leadership with us. Attended the ACCT Pacific Regional meeting online, the Helios Foundation reception, had a brief moment where I could roast Dr. Gonzalez. That was a lot of fun. Attended the mayor's State of the City and agree with everyone. She called out community colleges in ways that inform people how important the system is to students and families, but the city, the county, the region, that we're setting the stage for opportunities and workforce development that people have not had for a really long time, that we're working with them on scholarships and opportunities to get and receive wraparound services. It's great to have that sort of recognition, and we bring it back to you to know that you were mentioned, applauded, and greatly recognized for the outstanding all of the work that this system does every single day on behalf of students. So that was fun. I also attended Congressman Stanton's breakfast that was hosted here at Rio. And again, that was combined with the Tempe Chamber of Commerce, there was a lot of conversation about the role of community colleges in changing lives, but being part of the economic engine that is this county. So again, kudos to all of you. I would say that one of my more moving opportunities, though, and those of you who know me would understand why this is important and touched me, I was able to attend the Linda Rosenthal mentoring graduation. There were 26 women who work in this system who were able to receive a year of mentoring because of, again, everyone's good work and willingness to offer more than just work time to ensure and see that people are developing in this district, that we really are about igniting that talent and transforming those lives and empowering our system through people. So that was really moving for me. That was last week. And again, Many of you know I sit in Linda Rosenthal's seat, and every time I walk into this building and serve as a board member, I know she's watching. She's on one shoulder or not. I don't know if she's the good angel saying yay or the bad angel, well, you need to do that differently or to pay attention. But anyway, so we're all busy. As you can tell, we're doing lots of things, and I want to add my appreciation to all of you as you close out this academic year. And some of you are heading into summer work with us. Some of you aren't. Certainly, we have full-time staff. We're not going anywhere. Maybe a vacation here or there. But this work is that you do is really. Can't use that word. Blessed work on behalf of our students and our families. Just own that. Celebrate yourselves when you acknowledge and get up in the morning that you're going to work at the community college system. Look back in the years you're talking through the convocations and the graduations, and know that you made all of those things possible. They are successful because you are working to support people to be successful. And can't thank you enough as we close out this academic year. Hope everyone gets some sort of rest. And, you know, we'll be back at it in August. And the list is like, how long is it already, Dr. Gonzalez? Is it about this long? Yeah, okay. Well, it'll be twice that long by the time we get to August. So thank you, and appreciate Ms. Sexton's poem this evening. And, you know, there was a lot of sorrow in that poem. So I think we always need to think about how are we impacting people so they can move out of that sorrow or that pain that they feel. That's you. And we just get to be the ones to help you do that. So thank you for this evening. Go forth and have a great month and celebrations and all sorts of things. We'll see you soon. So thank you. I now adjourn the meeting.